It was 13 April 1999 when a large peaceful crowd had gathered at the Jallianwala Bagh in Amritsar to protest against the arrest of pro-Indian independence leader Dr. Saifuddin Kichliu and the Satyapal. As most of the people came from outside of the city, they were not aware of the martial law that was imposed on the morning. 5:30 in the evening, General Dyre, along with 50 troops with .303 rifle, arrived at the Bagh and blocked the main entrance. Without warning the crowd to disperse, Dyre ordered his troop to begin shooting towards the densest section of the crowd. Firing continued for approximately 10 minutes till the ammunition exhausted. Some of the soldiers initially shot in the air, at which Dyre shouted, "Fire low, what have you been brought here for?" Hundreds of people, including a 7-month-old infant, died at the spot and thousands got injured. Apart from the many deaths directly from the shooting, a number of people died of crushing in the stampedes at the narrow gates or by jumping into the well on the compound to escape the shooting. Dyer intentionally extended the curfew time so that the wounded could not be moved from there, and thus many injured died during the night. But after this barbaric massacre, what actually happened to General Dyer? Let's discuss this in detail. If you still not subscribe to this channel, please subscribe to the Gyan Tales so that more such topics can be delivered directly to you. Immediately after the event, Secretary of the State for War Winston Churchill openly condemned the attack and referred to as unutterably monstrous. But many Britons still thought him as a hero for saving the rule of British law in India. The Lieutenant Governor of Punjab that time endorsed Dyer and called the massacre as correct action. Eminent author Rudyard Kipling, who wrote the book Jungle Book, declared that Dyer did his duty as he saw it. On 14th October 1999, an inquiry committee was formed, which later more widely known as the Hunter Commission. On 19 November, Dyer was ordered to appear before the commission. Initially, Dyer felt insecure and doubted the rightness of what he had done. He was also worried about the reaction of his superior in the military, as he knew he had broken the law. So he forced the priest of the Golden Temple to do a fake conversion of him into Sikhism and honor him. He even had reporters ready to take pictures as proof. This was to get back the love and support among the Sikh and other communities, which he could show up to his seniors to avoid being relieved of his duty and deporting him back to England. But it didn't work. So he lied and changed the story until he felt sure that he had the support of his seniors. It was then he felt he could show off his intentions with pride before the Hunter Commission. Due to this mental support, although his military superior suggested him to be represented by a legal counsel at the inquiry, Dyer refused this suggestion and appeared alone. He stated the commission that he had gone to the Bagh with the deliberate intention of opening fire if he found a crowd assembled there. When Dyer was asked whether it was possible to disperse the crowd without firing, he explained, "I think it quite possible that I could have dispersed the crowd without firing, but they would have come back again and laughed, and I would have made what I consider a fool of myself." Dyer further stated that his intention had been to strike terror throughout the Punjab and in doing so reduce the mortal support of the rebels. He said he did not stop the shooting when the crowd began to disperse because he thought it was his duty to keep shooting until the crowd dispersed and the minimal shooting would not provide effective. In fact, he continued the shooting until the ammunition was almost exhausted. When he was asked by the commission whether did he make any effort to help the wounded after the shooting, he stated, "Certainly not, it was not my job. Hospitals were open and they could have gone there." Over the past several months, while the commission wrote its final report, the British press, as well as many MPs, turned increasingly hostile towards Dyer as the full extent of the massacre and his statements at the inquiry became widely known. In the meantime, Dyer became seriously ill with jaundice and arteriosclerosis and was hospitalized. The Hunter Commission did not impose any penal or disciplinary action because Dyer's action was condoned by various superiors. However, based on the Commission's report, Dyer was directed to resign from his post. Dyer resigned and was retired on a handsome pension. In the next 5 months, money poured in thick and fast from all the corners of the empire. The rich, the poor, the clergy, and the army from Calcutta to Colombo contributed. Books, jewelry, and stamps were sold to raise funds as well. Many British Indian newspapers also took part in fundraising. For example, the Calcutta Statesman, the Rangoon Times and Press, the Madras Mail and the Englishman. The Morning Post claimed Dyer was the man who saved India and started a benefit fund which raised over 26,000 sterling, a huge sum in those days, equivalent to almost 10 lakh euro in 2021. A 13-woman committee was constituted to present him with a sword of honor and a purse. The Morning Post had supported Dyer's action on the grounds that the massacre was necessary to protect the honor of the European. Rudyard Kipling contributed to this fund, and some sources claim that the line "the man who saved India" came from Kipling. However, despite the funds and the huge public support, Dyer wasn't a happy man. He had been diagnosed with arteriosclerosis, for which the only cure was rest. The slightest hint of excitement could induce a heart attack or a stroke. Thus, Dyer suffered a series of strokes during the last years of his life and died of cerebral hemorrhage on 23rd July 1927. On his deathbed, Dyer reportedly said, "So many people who knew the condition of Amritsar say I did right, but so many others say I did wrong. I only want to die and know from my makers whether I did right or wrong." The Morning Post remembered him after his death with the article "The Man Who Saved India" and the line "He did his duty." But the Westminster Gazette wrote a contrary opinion. It said, "No British action during the whole course of our history in India has struck a severe blow to Indian faith in British justice than the massacre at Amritsar." Also, there was no memorial stone made to Dyer and no known resting place for his ashes. His wife destroyed all his papers. She was careful not to leave anything behind. The great-grandchildren today hardly have any effects or photograph or any living memory of Dyer. His wife wanted the memory to be gradually forgotten. So this was all about this episode. If you really like our efforts, then please like, share and subscribe to the Gyan Tales for more such exciting topics.